Right on. Welcome back, Wrench Nation. Get on to WrenchNation.tv. You can hang on the website or catch the podcast if you're in and out today's show. One of the things that can happen, and look, we see it in the garage. We can see. Now, we can't have too much of it because we'd be out of business. But once in a while, we have an install error. We didn't install a part properly. We're modest. We're humble. Some of you can experience the same. And that football game that you were going to watch at 1 o'clock just went awry because the cars all tore apart and that alternator didn't fit. Well, to help us navigate some of the most common installation errors of some of those auto parts that you're installing, we have Nelson Davis, ASC Certified Master Tech, Director of Training, Technical Instructor for Motor Car Parts of America. Welcome, Nelson.
Thank you, Frank. Thanks for having us on.
Yeah, and kudos to you. We always give props up to anyone that's attained that ASE, Automotive Service Excellence, Master Technician, L1 Certified. How long have you been a master?
Probably close to 30 years.
We're bowing to you right now. We're bowing you. We have two masters in the garage. And just for you guys, you know, tuning in on that, like you hear master and it's like, oh, that sounds highfalutin.
Yeah.
No, this is someone that's really earned through experience, training, each certification of a system under the vehicle. So brakes, AC. So we want to acknowledge that. And Nelson, what are we getting wrong? If we were to snapshot America right now, and if it's fair to ask, what is the one part that most folks are just not getting right by way of install? We're going to cover more systems, but is there a is it a battery? Is it an alternator? Is it a starter?
And he can only pick one? Nelson can only pick one part.
We're going to box them in. How about the highest level? What are the engineers seeing at MPA that say, wow, this part was returned, but it wasn't failing on its own? Could I ask that? Is that a maybe?
Well, I don't know if it's one part in particular. That's kind of tough to pick out. But I would say if there's one area or one category that's sort of all-encompassing, it would have to do with anything that's electronics-related.
Yeah.
And, you know, I know that's kind of a broad answer because there's so many things on cars these days that are controlled electronically or involve electronics, but that tends to cause people more problems than anything, whether it's electronics in the engine management system or with an alternator or with a starter or even with a brake or a transmission, brake system or transmission system. Anything that involves electronics tends to create a lot of problems for people.
What can folks watch out for? I know that we went from years ago, most parts were pretty much, especially electrical, the electronics and the processing of a vehicle were plug and play. But not as of recent, at least the last 10, 15, maybe even going back longer. If I were to install, let's say, an alternator that had some sort of computer command control function, whether, you know, are we talking ground or whatnot, are there any particulars that someone should watch out for when installing an alternator? Is there something extra by way of the steps they have to take to ensure that that is properly being recognized by all systems on the vehicle?
Yeah, there's a couple of things on alternators to be aware of and to watch out for. I would say the number one thing is paying careful attention to the battery itself, okay? So you can have different scenarios or different situations, but when an alternator in a car fails, and it legitimately fails, it might have been the original alternator on the car and it had 150,000 miles on it, let's say. So it finally quit and wore out. You know, the brushes wore out and it quit charging. When that happens, obviously, you know, if the customer drives it for a while before they get a chance to bring it into a shop and get it repaired, or even if they attempt to repair it themselves, they may drive that car for a day or so. And what happens is the battery, of course, gets severely discharged because the alternator is not charging it anymore, right?
Right.
So they get a new alternator. They put it on the car. It needs one. But now they're attempting to recharge that discharged battery with a brand-new alternator.
Yeah.
And that puts a severe strain on that alternator, causes it to overheat, and really causes it to fail prematurely. So 2 or 3 days later, a week later, you know, the new alternator that they installed has now failed also. Mm. And obviously they're quick to point the finger at the alternator saying it's defective and they're going to return it and it's under warranty, it's covered. So they get another one. But the real issue is they didn't take the time to properly charge that battery first. It was discharged because they drove it, you know, even for a brief period of time with a failed alternator.
Right. Let's talk specifications. I'm changing an alternator. Where does my battery need to be so I don't fry that new alternator?
Well, ideally, it should be at 12.6 volts. That indicates the battery is pretty close to 100% state of charge if it's at 12.6 volts. Anything less than 12.45 volts, you know, if we're just measuring across that battery with a multimeter, anything less than that tells you right off the bat that battery needs to be recharged.
Right. You know, we see this often in the garage, Susie, where we installed a battery a year ago. Of course, we did a whole full-on starting charging system test. Everything was fine except the battery. Battery failed, load test, replaced the battery. Year later, car comes in. I need another battery. I need to warranty it. It's like, okay, well, let's take a look. And sometimes that can be a difficult conversation to have someone. Parts are covered if they fail on their own. That's a hard one.
Right.
Nelson, we see this in the garage like that, and we want to protect our relationship, but when they came back in a year later, okay, yeah, the battery's dead. It's not under warranty. The alternator fried it. Now, we'll do some things in the shop to keep the peace and do our best to warranty it out. But you speak on a point that's so critical because folks can kind of go back and forth doing that alternator battery dance if they don't get it right up front.
Yeah, exactly. And, you know, the other scenario or the other situation that could occur, of course, is that perhaps the battery was the problem to begin with also. Perhaps it had a dead cell or a weak cell, and that took the alternator out. So, again, the car comes into a shop or it's a do-it-yourselfer, and they know it needs an alternator, so they put the alternator on there. And, again, it's, you know, 2 or 3 days later, 2 or 3 weeks later, something like that, that brand-new alternator has failed. Well, what caused it to fail and probably what caused the first alternator to fail, the original alternator to fail in the first place, was the fact that the battery had a dead cell or a weak cell. And, again, the alternator was overworking itself to try and compensate for that weak or dead cell in that battery, overheated and, you know, again, failed. And because nobody took the time to properly test or charge that battery, that's really what's causing these repeated alternator failures on these vehicles.
Yeah, we've seen our fair share in the garage. One thing I want to speak on as well, Susie, we also see an alternator's installed. Somebody's installed their alternator, and they were really good. They put a new battery. And then they're 3 months later coming in, and their alternator is not charging. There's a wiring issue. Well, the whole time, their engine mounts are shot, and that engine is doing the Macarena. I mean, it's lifting up. Speak to us, how critical is it to make sure that that engine, that whole assembly is sitting in its cradle properly with no movement, excessive movement, because that's going to pull wiring harnesses, yeah?
Yeah, absolutely. It can cause a lot of strain on the wiring harness, just like you said. It can cause connections to become loose. You know, it can affect the tension even of the belt on the car. There are all kinds of things that can happen because of loose or worn motor mounts that can affect the starting or charging system on a vehicle or the battery itself, too, for that matter.
Yeah.
You mentioned the opposite of the alternator not working. What would cause the alternator to overcharge?
Overcharge, yeah. Yeah. Well, first off, let's talk about what is the, with engine running, what is the specification for that battery charge-wise from a known good alternator? What's the voltage? What should that be?
Well, that really varies. It depends on the vehicle manufacturer. You know, each vehicle manufacturer has specifications for their charging system voltage range, and it's typically a little bit of a range, too, okay? There's a, you know, a low end or a high end for all cars. And it's fairly similar among all vehicles, but it does vary somewhat between vehicle manufacturers. So it's always critical or always important to check the vehicle manufacturer's specifications for charging system voltage on a particular vehicle to make sure that, you know, you're testing it correctly.
Yeah. Would you say, I mean, I will hold you to this, and we do in the garage, every car is different, but a range would be 13.8 to 14.2. 13.8 volts to 14.2 volts, maybe?
Well, on some modern cars, it can go a little bit lower than that and even a little bit higher than that in some cases.
Gotcha.
Again, it really does depend on the vehicle. you know, older vehicles, yeah, maybe the range was a little narrower than it is on more modern vehicles. But, yeah, when you get into modern vehicles, it could be a little lower than that and a little higher than the 14.1 or 14.2 you mentioned on the high end.
Yeah, check those specifications. Susie had mentioned, what's the story now with an alternator that's overcharging? Perhaps it's sulfating a battery, battery's bloating, you got acid all over the place. What's happening there with an alternator that's overcharging?
Well, that could certainly be a problem with the alternator itself, okay? You know, whether it's internally regulated or externally regulated, there could be a problem with the alternator. There could also be a problem in the wiring, as you mentioned, you know, a circuit problem of some sort, which will then cause the alternator to overcharge.
Makes sense, yeah. So it's critical. Check your specifications. Make sure those motor mounts, if you guys are putting those alternators in or anything in your engine having to do with, wiring and hydraulic lines, we have a tendency to forget about the motor mount. Some of you are driving around and like, oh, I've heard that clunk for a year. It's not affecting. And boy, that could be a disastrous car repair bill for you.
Yeah, because you don't think engine mounts even close to electrical issues.
Yeah, and I don't think it's something they check really in this sort of quick lane drive-through lube shops. You know, most good garages are going to give you a report on those engine mounts. I want you guys to grab a pen if you're not driving. I want you to take this number, MPA, MotorCarPartsOfAmerica.com. That website, there's great videos that you can catch, as well as a tech support center, 1-800-228-9672. You're not alone. You know, if you need help, and it's one of the things, we buy a ton of MPA product, and the fact is, MPA gives us that support, and that's what you guys want. Because you're going to run into some snags, and so that is critical. I want you to stay tuned, guys. Nelson, we're going to have you come back in for segment three. I'd like to talk a little bit more about the hydraulics, perhaps brake master cylinder, maybe a little bench bleeding process, as well as brake pads. Everyone has a certain flavor of brake pad. Where are we getting that wrong by the way of installation? And squeeze. Stay tuned, Wrench Nation. Support for Wrench Nation Car Talk, the smart choice for auto parts, Pronto National Association. Pronto is committed to the independent automotive aftermarket and demonstrates leadership within the automotive industry. Pronto Association is made up of nearly 100 member auto part distributors. Visit pronto-net.com. Automotive technical training, parts lineup, and representation of the automotive member community. Pronto-net.com. Vision collision. God forbid you get into an accident or you get a little bumper, fender, bender, slide, or even if you've got that shopping cart that ends up scratching the side of your newer ride. My friends at Vision Collision, they're certified. They deal with insurance companies, but also what I really like is they were able to deal with my situation. I didn't want to exercise my insurance, and I paid out of pocket, and they gave me a very fair price with quality work. So for any complete auto body paint and repair, you want that small business, the heart of business that treats you one-on-one. Vision Collision, 480-248-9049, visioncollision.com. When you're thinking about body shop or collision work, paint repair, dent repairs, collision, wheel restoration, Vision Collision is the way to go. Tell them Frank at Wrench Nation sent you. 480-248-9049. 480-248-9049, Vision Collision. Welcome back, Wrench Nation. Get on to wrenchnation.tv. Catch your favorite show. Girl, you think you got it bad. We're honored to have MotorCarParts.com, one of the world's largest automotive part manufacturers in the world. They are not only a strong force here in the United States, but across the globe. And we're honored to have Nelson Davis, ASC Certified Master Tech. Welcome back.
Thank you.
Yeah, all right. Welcome back.
Yay, Nelson's there.
Woo. Nelson's there.
Yay, Nelson. Yay.
We're trying to get people excited about car parts, Nelson.
Glad to be here.
We covered alternators. Now, I figured we'd go right into brake. I mean, there's several, obviously, parts under hood, but one of the more common problems that we can see in the garage is where somebody has done their own brakes and they're just squeaking away. Let's talk about the brake pads and in trying to keep it somewhat organized here, talk to us about the composition. We can throw out ceramic, semi-metallic, and organic. So let's talk about ceramic. What is ceramic brake pads doing that perhaps semi-metallic pads are not doing? What are they good for?
Well, they tend to be less noisy, number one, okay? You know, because there is no real heavy metallic content in a ceramic pad compared to a semi-metallic pad, obviously. That tends to make them a little quieter. Also, the thing about ceramic pads is they tend to not leave a lot of dust, dirt, and debris on people's wheels, right? A lot of people have, you know, custom wheels, fancy wheels, nice wheels on their car, and you know, they want to keep those things clean. They don't want to see brake dust and debris all over their wheels. So ceramic pads tend to prevent that from occurring. You know, they're much cleaner compared to semi-metallic pads.
Right. Now, I mentioned organic. I mean, I haven't seen organics in, well, I don't know, 20 years. But I guess there was a time where there was an organic pad, which was just a basic pad. We probably shouldn't even talk about that, because I don't think anybody's putting organic pads on. But just know, I guess they still could exist, organic pads, and that was without all of the, can we call it, additives to the composition?
Yeah, there are still what are called non-asbestos organic pads. Okay, so in the past, years ago, like you said, the pads were organic, but they contained a lot of asbestos. So you know, that was pretty much that's pretty much disappeared. So we still do have organic, non-asbestos organic pads that can be manufactured out of all kinds of different materials and compounds.
You know, it's amazing our history that, asbestos was a great part of our history.
Yeah.
And
unfortunate part of it.
It is.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, those days are long behind us. But so in terms of, I've got my car, I'm driving, let's say, a little Honda Civic, and I decide to go with ceramic pads. I'm getting a pair of rotors because my rotors are scored. They're ground down. You know, I've got down to my backing plate. In other words, that brake pad material, just kind of like the sole of your shoe, wore out. That lining is a wearable item. And I'm getting ready to do my pads and my rotors. Talk to us about where we can get this installation wrong by way of the hardware, all those mounting clips. How important is it to get that right, that hardware, that mounting clip assembly?
That is a good point, and that's very, very critical, okay? And there are actually different types of hardware, too. There's hardware for the caliper itself, and then there's hardware for the brake pads themselves, okay? And, you know, there's a little bit of overlap there between brake pad hardware and brake caliper hardware. But it is critical that hardware is addressed. It's either inspected and clean, thoroughly cleaned and lubricated properly if you're going to reuse it, or obviously if that hardware is damaged, if it's rusted or corroded or, you know, damaged in any way, then it should be replaced with new hardware. And the reason that's critical is it prevents excessive movement and vibration of the brake pads and the brake caliper itself, okay? It allows everything to move properly without any excessive movement, which will cause vibration and ultimately lead to noise issues, noise complaints.
I got to share with you, Nelson, I tend to lose people often when I use the analogy of blowing through a reeded instrument like a
flute?
No, flute's not reeded. Like a clarinet.
Like a clarinet.
There are harmonics. There's vibration. That little
not everybody's a musician, Frank.
I know. I lost
That's
everybody.
That's probably why you lose it.
They look at me. Just do my breaks and be quiet. But what you're saying...
You lost me. I said a flute.
I'll tell you what. Let's put it to you this way. You guys are listening and saying, okay, brake pads, hardware. Nobody's ever said anything about hardware. Think of that mattress spring or that mattress sitting in its box, your furniture... nice, comfy, and cozy. If that's off kilter or not seated properly, what's going to happen to the mattress? You could have some noise. You can have some movement. It's not sitting in its seat.
Right.
Is that a good explanation, Nelson?
Yeah, no, that's great. And actually, you're right. I mean, it's noise is a result of excessive vibration of some sort in that brake system somewhere, okay? And it's critical also that all of those components in the brake system maintain proper alignment or proper geometry with one another, okay? So that the movement that does occur is occurring accurately and correctly and precisely. So it's when we get unwanted movement an excessive movement that ultimately leads to vibration and then noise. And that hardware helps to dampen that vibration and that movement and prevent excessive movement or movement in the wrong direction, so to speak, or in the wrong manner, so that we don't get that vibration and we don't get that noise.
I was trying to get the people to think of Miles Davis in their brakes.
Miles Davis, there you go.
Well, he was a trumpet player.
I have a question because we just got done talking about the ceramic brakes. Now, when I'm ordering parts for a vehicle and I see a semi-metallic brake pad and it says it is the OE preferred, am I going to, if I use a ceramic pad in lieu of that semi-metallic, am I modifying anything or am I jeopardizing? Because the customer doesn't came in for noise. I want to make sure that there is no noise.
And in your mind, you're doing premium, ceramic, less dusting, quiet. That's a great question. If it calls for semi-metallic, does it hurt to upgrade to ceramic?
Now, that is a great question, actually. And I'll tell you, nowadays it can be a little bit confusing, especially for a do-it-yourself type person that works on his own car. But it can even be a little bit confusing, I think, for technicians and shop owners because there are a lot of different types of brake friction material out there, okay? And, you know, there's advertising and promotion that goes along with all of this, these different types of brake pads. And, you know, I guess to some extent, some of it's hype even. So what's important and what's most critical and most important is that you use a quality brake pad, number one. And you use a quality brake pad that has specific friction material or vehicle application specific friction material. In other words, what the OE manufacturer specified for that particular vehicle, whether it was semi-metallic, whether it was ceramic, that you're using a replacement brake pad that's compatible and is also has vehicle-specific friction material on it.
Okay? Yeah, I mean, we do find that there are some platforms still out there that, yeah, OE is semi-metallic, and we'll explain that. And at the same time, if the complaint is excessive dusting on those, you know, $2,000 set of rims, we'll just let them know we can upgrade to a ceramic, and typically we're paying attention to brake rotors. Let's talk about that, too. I think this is important. These ceramic brake pads, they are a harder brake pad, aren't they? Does that require a difference in the brake rotor? Could we get into cutting up some rotors with ceramics if we don't have the right brake rotor? Because I believe they're harder brake pads, aren't they?
Well, compared to semi-metallic, not necessarily.
Okay, semi-metallic is the harder one.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
Okay. So yeah, there's going to be some trade-offs there. And, you know, in answer to Susie's question, you know, would it hurt or would it be okay or acceptable to upgrade? So, yeah, in some cases you can do that. But remember, when you do that, you're also going to sacrifice something on the other end. Okay? So, for example, if her car came equipped with the semi-metallic pads, if that's what the manufacturer specified for that particular type of vehicle, and she upgrades to ceramic pads, for example, to lessen the chance of dusting the wheels, okay, then perhaps under certain conditions, that brake system on that car won't stop that car as effectively as it would if it had the semi-metallic pads on it.
It's a softer pad.
Wow.
That it was specified for.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Okay. And I think what you're saying, Nelson, which is awesome, don't take this lightly. There's a reason why engineers specified part applications, design. We see stuff on the internet. And we're like, oh, that's cheaper. Let's buy it there. Not always, because it may not be the exact fit specification requirement. Does that answer your question? That's a good point.
Yeah, it does. It does. And I also got to take it a step further. So the other day we had a Transit, a Ford Transit.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And it needed brakes. And so when I was talking to the extended warranty company, they were ensuring that all the bolts were replaced as well, because they were saying that the bolts were a one-time use.
Yes, the top hat rotor style. Some of you have that design. And so I'll speak on that. There are other parts to that brake system that, you know, perhaps if you're getting into calipers, maybe a good idea to get. Talk to us about that, Nelson, how important it is to get what needs to be replaced. Those are not reusable bolts.
Yeah, there are some vehicles out there actually that specify when you replace the caliper or the caliper bracket is removed from the vehicle, for example, to service the brake system on that car. Just like you said, those bolts are not reusable in some cases. So you always have to refer to the vehicle manufacturer service information, okay? And look at the instructions and the details there and the procedures there that are involved with, let's say, just replacing the brake pads and the rotors or the calipers on that particular vehicle. In some cases, the manufacturer may specify that the caliper mounting bolts or the caliper bracket bolts are not reusable. They have to be replaced.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Just like you mentioned on the Transit van.
I want you guys to get on to motorcarparts.com. It's a plethora resource of great videos. It's part of their Part Smart educational program. It's always best to research. And I speak to a lot of you that are sort of on the weekends doing your thing. You don't have to be fearful, but it's really about researching. Get your homework right, and that way you can have an easy-peasy repair process and actually enjoy fixing your car. If you're an automotive service operator or technician, you want to get on to motorcarparts.com. It's a great professional platform as well. They've added a ton of great intents, which you'd find on some of these high-level training certification programs. You can have all of that backing with the training that they have with those videos. Lots going under the hood. I always tell my people, Nelson, and I think this is fair, fixing cars is easy. Where it gets difficult is, did we diagnose it right, and did we actually fix it? Wouldn't you agree?
Yeah, there's a lot of truth to that, I think. Yep.
Yeah, no doubt. So the hydraulics, let's get into, someone may have a brake pedal that goes to the floor and, you know, they're not seeing anything major leaking brake fluid at their wheels. The calipers look good. The wheel cylinders, if they have wheel cylinders, look good. But they've determined that they are seeing fluid right at the backside of that brake master cylinder kissing up against the brake booster. We've had folks come into the garage where they've attempted to install that hydraulic brake master cylinder and the brakes just felt really spongy or just didn't feel right. Where can we get it wrong when installing a brake master cylinder?
Well, the number one thing there is making sure that that master cylinder is bench bled properly before it's installed on the vehicle.
For those that don't know, what is bench bleeding?
Well, it's a process that involves removing the air from the master cylinder. Since that thing's just been sitting on a shelf for a while, it hasn't had any fluid in it. There's quite a bit of air that's trapped within that master cylinder's bore. And that air has to be removed before the master cylinder is actually installed on the vehicle. So really it involves, you know, a process, and there are different methods for bench bleeding master cylinders, but it's a process that involves mounting it typically in a vise and then filling it with the correct brake fluid for that vehicle, fresh brake fluid out of a sealed container that's, correct for that particular vehicle that they're working on. And then using a process, which can be fairly simple, and again, there are different methods for doing it, but using a process to remove that air out of that master cylinder's bore and to get it completely free of air before it's actually even installed on the vehicle in the first place.
So it's that air pocket that may be circulating through the system that's causing a funky pedal that would feel, doesn't have quite the pedal height, or it feels spongy if we don't get that air out.
Exactly. Okay, so the air is not compressible like the fluid itself is, and you end up losing a lot of your pedal travel. If there's air trapped within the master cylinder itself or in the brake system anywhere, you end up losing a lot of your pedal travel because you're compressing that air instead of just pushing the fluid throughout the hydraulic part of the brake system.
It's critical to get it right.
It's extremely critical, yes.
One thing, I mean, I wouldn't say it's a standard of what we're seeing, but I know with our peers on the other side of the Mississippi, in some of the oxidized rust belt areas, a brake job is a pretty big to-do because everything is rusted and everything breaks. We're spoiled here in the desert. We don't get a whole lot of rust on these vehicles. In fact, my guys have to go through therapy if they deal with a car that has rust. That's the truth of it. But I think that one would agree when they're looking at their brake system, certainly from these rusted, oxidized areas of the country, they may be into it for more than just face value. And I think that's the proper planning. So in other words, if you have a brake squeak and you're saying, well, I need pads, I'm going to do my rotors. Well, do the job right. Maybe you need brake lines because they're collapsing internally. Maybe you need those brake calipers because then there you're going to have additional. You may have a nice quiet car now. It's not squeaking, but now that pedal starts to fade. You didn't have that prior. I think I'm speaking to those of you that can get it. Please don't show up on this side of the Mississippi with your... because really, Nelson, this is the truth of it. We don't work on a whole lot of rusty stuff.
We're spoiled.
It is an issue, though. You're right. It's absolutely an issue in probably most parts of the country, really, not just the Midwest, although it's certainly worse there. The thing about brakes, really, I guess... You know, when it comes to servicing the brake system on a car, most people will tell you that it's, for the most part, a fairly simple process, a fairly simple repair compared to a lot of other things on cars, right? It's fairly easy to do. A lot of do-it-yourselfers can do it, and certainly, you know, shops make a lot of money repairing brake problems on their customers' vehicles. But the thing about brake service that I've always found critical and important is that you really, really have to pay attention to all the details, okay? You can't overlook anything. You can't shortcut anything. You really got to pay attention to all the little small things, the rust, the corrosion. You got to make sure things are properly lubricated and lubricated with the correct type of lubricant. Bolts are torqued down to proper specifications, things like that. Even a proper seating in of the brake pads after you've finished the brake job on the car is important. So it's all the little details that make the difference in doing just a simple brake job and causing problems or causing issues versus, you take care and you pay attention to all those details and you look at all those little things and you do the job carefully and thoroughly. And then you end up with really a professional brake job that doesn't have problems.
Attention to detail is critical. You know, I tell our squad, our team, you know, attention to detail. It's the same like getting on the battlefield. Can you please make sure that you have ammo in your weapon right now? We're at battle. In other words, did you research? Did we get all the parts we needed to do the job right? Did we probe for the right symptoms? I mean, we see this, Susie, a lot.
Yeah, we do. But I'm going to take it another step further because I have old cars, old school, so I get to push a pedal for my emergency brake. I get to pull a lever for my emergency brake. But now I'm seeing more and more there's electric brakes.
Well, the e-brake.
Right, the e-brake.
Yeah, explain to folks that they may get into the rear brakes and then they discover something. Holy cow, what is that thing, that caliper? It doesn't push in with a standard C-clamp or what have you. Talk to us about the rear brakes and what someone may run into regarding an electrical or electronic, I should say.
Electronic, yeah.
Somewhat computer-controlled caliper. Talk to us on that.
Yeah, sure. That's, you know, we're seeing more and more of that all the time with electric parking brakes, as you mentioned, on vehicles. So there's a small little electric motor on many vehicles that's actually attached to that brake caliper, and its purpose really is to activate that caliper electronically through this little motor to activate the parking brake on the vehicle when you park it and you shut it off. So instead of pushing down on a pedal or pulling up on a lever, as Susie mentioned, you'll typically just push a button of some sort, and that will send a signal to a computer, and that computer will then command that motor to actuate that caliper and lock the parking brake or emergency brake on the vehicle. So when it comes time to service the vehicle, as you mentioned, if somebody's not familiar with that type of a system and they pull that caliper off there and they look at it, they're like, holy mackerel, this thing's got an electric motor on it, you know? And they may be thinking that just like in the past, they would push that piston in with a C-clamp or a special depressor tool.
That's a bad day in your driveway. Yeah, that's a bad day in your driveway because now what happens is you almost need, it's all computer control commanded, mm-hmm. right? And I can only feel for someone in their driveway who's got everything tore apart.
Oh, no.
And it's like, oh gosh, what do I do? Well, maybe they're calling a mobile mechanic. I don't know what they're doing.
Call the MPA's tech support.
Yeah, there. Yeah. Well, they'll just tell you're going to have to get a scan tool.
I think it goes back to what you were saying, that you know, it's important that people research and look at the vehicle service information whenever they get in there and they're attempting to repair something that they're not familiar with or they don't have a good understanding of. A little bit of research and, you know, looking at the vehicle service information can go a long ways towards helping them to properly repair the vehicle, whether that's a do-it-yourself or a professional technician, either way.
Absolutely. And I invite you guys, get on to Motor Parts, actually motorcarparts.com, but also here locally or, hey, nationally, if you want to call us, 480-726-6400. You don't have to come in our garage to spend money. If you're under hood, we support that all day long. We get dozens of those calls a month, a week sometimes, it seems. Right around tax season, some of you are trying to fix your stuff. Hey, we want to make sure you're good. And, you know, as Nelson said, it is really preparation, especially if you have a newer vehicle. And I speak to all of you Uncle Louis that have been wrenching in your backyards for 30 years. You're like, I got this. Well, you may not. And so it's best to just prepare. And if you don't have that information, whether you go on to motorcarparts.com or give us a call, we want to help. Nelson, this is the kind of show that could be a long. We could keep going and going.
I learned a lot.
I know you
actually. I think I am a master certified service writer now because of you, Nelson.
You are.
Thank you, Frank.
Yeah.
Nice.
See what you did, Mr. Nelson.
No, I can talk for days about cars, of course.
Yes. Well, we hope to meet you someday soon when we get back to some normalcy at these expo events. For now, we've got Zoomitis, and we're online doing our thing, I guess, but
I hear you.
An honor to have you on. If you are in the Chandler, Arizona area outside of Phoenix, man, our shop is your shop. Our home is your home. And we got the best coffee out of a Keurig, a cup waiting for you. Thank you, Mr. Nelson Davis with Motor Car Parts of America. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you. I appreciate it. And if I'm ever in that area, I'll make it a point to stop by for sure.
Please do. Yeah. You know, I got a lot of respect for not only the sort of technician that's acquired the master certs and L1, which is advanced drivability, but the field instructor, the field trainer, the guy, and we've had him in the garage.
Yeah.
Who comes out, hey, how are you guys doing? By the way, here's these service bulletins. There are certain things you need to know about these parts that have changed, updated designs. And so you guys know, I'll have you know, we add a couple of 100,000 pages to our software at least twice a year about the new data, new flow charts, new specifications to these vehicles we work on. So most good garages are going to have that system dialed in. Boy, it is a quick show. I got one more reminder. A lot of you need scholarships. The money's there. TechForce Foundation, techforce.org. Get on there. There's some scholarships, people. You're an upcoming wrench, mechanic, technician, welder, techforce.org. Get onto that website.
And make your dreams come true.
Make your dreams come true. Hey, build that $200 car. It's all good. Man, good show, Susie.
It is, Frank.
Right
on. Always fun.
Love to hang with you guys. As I tell you every week, be safe, hug each other, and never forget to hug a mechanic.
I'm made of plastic.